Okay, I think we are recording now. Okay, good morning again, everybody. I guess 11 o'clock is not really morning, but it's not really afternoon as well. So we have basically gone through more than half of the unit already. So I think next week we will go to mass transport. So for this week, we will discuss some of the examples on the heat transport, okay, that we have not covered in the previous drop-in sessions. So I guess hi Daniel. Good morning, Daniel. Daniel, can I hear your sound? Everything okay? Would you be able to reply me back through your mic? All good, Daniel? You hear me okay? Okay, so for today's drop-in sessions, we will discuss two short examples, and then for tomorrow drop-in session, we will discuss one example that is a bit longer, I think. That one is a bit more lengthy and complex compared to these examples. Okay, so if you remember when I first give you on the week one, that one is we give through a different level of modelings. Okay, so this example is almost the same with that a particular example, except that in here we have instead of the rod, we have a cooling fin. Hi Evangeline, how are you doing, Evangeline? Are you well? Can I hear your sound if you don't mind? So heat conductions in a cooling fin. So imagine that you have something like this, okay? And then you have a wall, and then you have a fin in here. So the fin in here is used to increase the area available for the heat transfer between the metal walls and poorly conducting fluids such as gases. Okay? So if you remember when if I'm not sure because I was born in 1980, so at that time the generations we use an old motorcycle, and in the old motorcycle we have a carburetor. So the carburetors generally contains protruding part of the protruding metal part like this, and those metal parts I think is being used to improve the heat transfer between the carburetor and the surrounding air. Okay, I used to ride the motorcycles. Okay, and that motorcycle is a bit old style motorcycle. Is if you use like Honda motorcycle or that kind of motorcycle, then you remember that there is a part that protrudes from the carburetors like this. Okay, but it is a bit longer. But for this example, we just use a simplified configurations. Okay, so imagine we have something like this, and then where we take 000 from this particular point. So this particular point is basically the halfway between the bottom and the top, between the bottom and the top part of the fin. Okay, and it lies in the interface between the wall with the fin. Okay, and then we have a fin with the length of L, with the thickness of 2B, and then with the width of W in here. So the coordinate 0 in here is taken in between the top and the bottom. So from this 0 to the top, it will be B. From this particular 0 coordinates to the bottom, it will be B. Okay, so in reality, if we talk about the comparisons between the assumptions that we take in this particular problem with the two situations, then we can compare it side by side. So for example, in the two situations, then the temperature will be a function of x, y, and z. But the dependence of z is more important. Why? Because we took the variations in terms of the Z is much more wider in comparison to the variations in Y and the comparisons in X. Okay, so that's why we are more interested in the temperature as a function of Z. That will be so in the model we can just simply take that T is a function of Z alone. And then a small quantity of heat is lost from the fin at the end. So the from the fin at the end meaning that this one will be B multiplied by W. Okay, so this one 2B B multiplied by W is this one. 2B multiplied by W is this particular area in here. Okay, and at the edges area 2BL plus BL. So basically this is the one that I meant at the end is here, and then you remember that we have another opposite side at the other side in there. So there will be 2BL plus 2BL over in that side, right? So we just assume that because the area of the top and then the bottom is much larger than this area, that area and then particular area, so we can assume that no heat loss is lost from the end or from the edges. Okay, and then remember Newton's law of cooling. So the heat transfer coefficient is generally a function of the position. So the edge at this particular position may be different with the edge at this particular position. But for this particular model, we make our life simple. Basically, we take that the edge is constant. Only T, or temperature, depends on Z. Okay, so by doing that thing, then we can start with the energy balance. Now, because the variations is in terms of the variations is basically the temperature as a function of Z, so we take the shell with the thickness of delta Z. Okay, once we take that thing, then we sketch and then we put in what happens with this. So there is a heat in by conduction in this side, there is a heat out by conduction, and then there is a heat out by transfer to airstream. Remember that we don't only have the heat transfer out on the top, but we also have the heat transfer out also to the bottom. So in this respect, the area is doubled. So if you only multiply by one of this, then that will be W multiplied by delta Z. But you have to remember that you have to account for the top and the bottom. So that means you need to multiply by 2W delta Z. Okay. So what you have to do in here is the same with what we have shown earlier in our week one example. For example, you simply divide by 2BW delta Z. By dividing like that, then you will get these equations in here, and then you can substitute Fourier's law. After you substitute the Fourier's law, then you end up with the second order ordinary differential equations. Okay, then we need to solve this second order ordinary differential equation using two boundary condition, because if we solve second order ordinary differential equations, then we have two constants. If we solve a first order ordinary differential equation, then we have one constant. So what are the boundary conditions? So at Z equals zero, the temperature of the fin is equal to the temperature of the wall, which is generally will be hotter than the temperature of the ambient, because the purpose of the heat of the fin is basically to make the cooling faster, right? Hi Gladys, can you hear me? Just let me know if you cannot hear me, okay, Gladys? Then the BC2 at Z equal L, so at this particular position in here, then dT over dZ is equal zero. Okay, so meaning that after we have all these things, then what we want to do is to simplify the ordinary second order ordinary differential equation. So we can use the dimensionless variables like this to solve the problem. Okay, and then you will ask me why we choose this dimensionless temperature. Actually, the choice of the dimensionless temperature is arbitrary, meaning that you can choose whatever the dimensionless temperature, but we need to look at the form of the differential equations, and then if we pick a certain configurations of these dimensionless variables, then we will end up with the simplified equations. And generally, those simplified equations are the underlying factor that makes us choose a specific form of the dimensionless variables. Okay, so if we do all of these things, okay, and remember that we have to do all these things, and then don't forget to do a chain a chain rule in here. So for example, if I want to change the dz onto this one, then you remember that this is cancelling with this one. So this particular form will be equal to this particular form, okay? And then this particular form will be equal to this particular form. I'm just using a chain rule to eliminate the constants in the dimensionless variables. So then if we do that, the chain rule, then we know that these equations in here basically equal to these equations in here. Okay, and then the boundary conditions in here equal to this. So meaning that at this particular value of zero, then the dimensionless temperature will be equal to one. Okay, and then at this particular dimensionless variable where this one is equal to one, then the derivative of the dimensionless temperature with respect to this particular dimensionless variables will be equal to zero. Okay, so I don't think I need to go into details for these things. What I normally in my papers I put everything in detail because I do want to know why I have the final answers. Okay, and then it's not the final answer that is correct, but the process that is correct. So normally I derive everything. And if you look at my week one derivations, then you know that this all is just repeating what I have given in the week one derivation. Okay, so then you continue, and then you know that you can basically this second order ordinary differential equation can be solved using these particular solutions in here. So basically, you have to know the value of the C and the D based on your boundary condition that is given in here. So if you substitute the boundary conditions, the first one, you will get this particular solution, right? Hi Saif, long time no see. You can hear me, Saif? Okay, let me know if there's anything that is not clear, then just stop me, okay, or if I'm going too fast. And then once you get these things, don't forget to put in your original equations again. So you substitute whatever the value that is known. So for example, C is equal 1, then you put in this 1. Then we go into the BC2. Now, for the BC2, we need to differentiate these equations in here, right? So we differentiate, then we know that the T in here is basically minus tangent hyperbolic of n. Okay, then we substitute back the C and then the D into these original equations, then we can get these particular equations in here. Okay, and then I have also have a note in here that n is put before this n multiplied by this dimensionless distance variable because n is always lower or at most equal to n. Okay, so then we go with the identity for the hyperbolic trigonometric. You get this one. Then we can simplify this form further into these equations in here. Then once we get the equation, then we have to reflect back that this equation is only valid if the heat loss at the end and at the edges are negligible. Okay, meaning that if we have this particular configurations where basically the area of the fin on the top and the bottom is much more larger compared with the area in the side and in the end, because we take it in the assumptions that we neglect these two part, this particular area in here, this particular area, and the other area on the other side there. Okay, so then it's basically after you derive everything, then you need to relook back again into your assumptions and think back, right? And then the effectiveness of the fin surface is defined by the actual rate of the heat loss from the fin divided by the rate of heat loss from isothermal fin at TW. So the denominator in here reflect the fact that if all the temperatures in the fin is at TW, okay, there is no temperature variations, then the fin will be a perfect fin basically, and the heat transfer will be the best heat transfer that you will get. But it's not always the case like that, right? Because there is a variation. So that's why you are dividing it by the ideal case scenario, the case where the rate of the heat loss will be the highest. Okay, then if you integrate like this, then don't forget to go back into the definitions of your variables again, right? You go back into the definition of the variable. Sometimes you need to put in your dimensionless variables because you remember that your T minus TA is equal to this multiplied by the TW minus TA. Okay, and then you continue. You can cancel out whatever the terms that you need to cancel. Once you get this thing, then you will be able to find that your effectiveness is equal 1 over n sine hyperbolic of the n divided by the cos h cos hyperbolic n. Okay, so this will be related with what I have given you in the week 1 where we discuss about the derivations of the different level of the modeling for the case of the cooling of a hot solvent, basically. So this one is just a fin. So for my explanations up to here, do you have any questions so far for this particular example? Any questions? All of this seems to be quite straightforward, eh? Everybody. Your assignment has been released since I think Monday, so you can start with that assignment. And just bear in mind that for the assignment, because there I think more than 1 month is given to the assignment, so if you want to aim for the very high score, then you have to basically cover everything, including the units, whatever, the figure, the picture, everything, make it so clear, everything. And basically you treat everything as if Jaka wants to get a complete derivation, as if I'm somebody that doesn't understand everything. So I want to check the unit consistency, the unit constellations, the figure. You need to put in everything into the figure. So how do you derive this particular step? How did you derive the particular step? Because it's very important. Like I said again, it's not only the final answer that is matter, but all the processes that lead to the correct answer that is important. It means that you are giving you're giving a thought into what you do. And later when you become an engineer, this is more important than if you just trying to get the solutions only. Okay, so if there is no questions, then I will move into another example again. Okay, another example that I will discuss, the next one, is the heat conduction with a viscous heat source. So this if you go and look at the canvas, then the ordering of the appearance for these two is actually I discussed this sooner than this, then I discussed the heat conductions in here. But anyway, I think that sometimes when you try to move it a little bit, the discussions, then it may help a bit as well. Okay, so imagine that you have the flow of an incompressible Newtonian fluid between the two coaxial cylinders. So you have two cylinders, the inner cylinder and then the outer cylinders. Okay, the inner cylinder does not move, but the outer cylinder move. Okay, because there is a moving, or the outer cylinder basically rotates, then you will basically have a cylindrical shell of fluid that rubs against adjacent shell of fluid. So if you neglected the effect of the curvature, you can basically consider that you take these particular sections in here, but instead of caring much more about the curvature in here, like if you have a much larger air, for example, okay, then this means that you can just neglect the curvature effect, and then you can take it like this, because the outer cylinder move with the velocity of FB equal R multiplied by this omega. That means you will have a velocity profile that varies basically from zero to this VB on the top. Okay, so this one is something that we deal in the momentum transport. So this momentum transport is happening in here basically. Okay, now if the velocity is quite high, then there is a friction between the adjacent layer of the fluid that will be converted into the thermal energy. Okay, this volume heat source resulting from this viscous dissipation can be designated by the symbol of SV. Previously, we have discussed the case where we have a cylinder and then some of the electrical energy dissipates into heat. Okay, I remember that thing. I think that one was given on the week 5, if I'm not wrong. And then we also have an example where we discussed heat conductions, where there is a nuclear energy that is generated within the core of the cylinder and the core of the sphere. Okay, so this one is giving you an illustration of what happens if some of the momentum momentum related phenomena is being converted into the heat. Okay, then this will come when we use the term the combined energy flux vector. Okay, so what we do in here is we simply take the shell with the thickness of delta x, because the velocity varies in the x direction, and then we expect that there will be a temperature profile as a function of x as well. Okay, these things is a bit simplified cases. Again, we discuss only a simplified cases. We don't really go into a complex sample, into a complex example in here. Now, if we take this element with the shell thickness of delta x, then what we need to do is we need to multiply with the area of this shell element WL multiplied by the combined energy flux. Okay, now we only have in and out, but we don't have the production term, because the production term is not being specified anyway in the problem statement, so meaning that we don't have any. If we do that thing, then we know that the combined energy flux is equal to a constant. Then we can go back again and inspect our combined energy flux vector term. This consisting of the conductions, and then there is a convection contributions, and then there is a work contribution as well in here. Okay, then we can see that the conduction term can be explained by these particular equations. Okay, and then what we need to do in here is also check the unit. We need to make sure that all these unit in here having the same unit. Okay, then the unit in here is basically since this one is called in terms of the flux, so it should be in terms of the joule per second meter square. So the unit for the Q should be the same with the unit for the T for this tau multiplied by V. Okay, and then also have to be the same with this particular unit in here as well. Then we start looking at one by one. The convective energy flux vector along x direction is zero because there is no flow along the x direction. The flow, the velocity is along the z direction. Okay, so then this means is because FPX is zero, that means that this component will be basically zero. Okay, and then we have the molecular heat flux vector along the x direction. How about the molecular work flux vector? So this can be deconvoluted into a three contributions. And then the Vx is equal to zero, and then Vy is equal to zero. Why? Because your y is basically on the side of going to my side or going into that side. So meaning that we don't have any particular velocity in the directions of going into the paper or going out of the paper. So that means this one will be zero, this one will be zero. But we have tau xz multiplied by the pz in here. And then if we go back into the general Newton law of viscosity, we can know that this particular term is equal to this particular term, right? So in essence, we have these equations in here. The first one is coming from the conduction term. The second one coming from the convective term, and these are equal to C1, right? And then Vz in here, we can look back into here, and then we can see that basically there will be a linear variations in terms of the temperature, in terms of the velocity from the bottom to the top. So we can take that basically the Vz is equal Vb multiplied by x divided by the b. B is the distance between the bottom cylinder, between the inner cylinder with the outer cylinder. Okay, if we do that thing, then we can continue in here. And then if we go and scrutinize the units of this mu multiplied by phi b, phi b of divided by b squared, we will know that this is actually the rate of the viscous heat production per unit volume SV. So I don't really trust what Bert told me in their book. So what I did is I checked the unit. When I check the unit, then I will know that this basically joule per second meter cube. Okay. So this one is per unit volume meter cube. Flux is per unit of the surface area. So it's different. Okay. Then we can do a little bit of manipulations in here. And then we can integrate to get this particular temperature profile. But in here, we need to find the two values of the constant C1 and C2. Okay. Now we go back again into the figure again and inspect that at x equals 0, T is equal T naught. At x equal B, the temperature is equal TB. Okay. Then we substitute it in. We know that the T naught is equal C2. Okay, and then for the BC, C1 is equal this. And then we can get that the value of the temperature is equal this, but a slightly bit more the derivations and the manipulations of the terms are required in order for us to get these terms in here. And this is provided that TB, or this one is not equal to the T naught, right? If the TB is equal T naught, then you need to start with this. After you get the BC1, then you need to redo again the substitution process for the BC2, and substituting that the T in here is equal T naught. If you do so, then you will get the profile of like this. So these equations in here is for this particular problem in case the TB is not equal to the T naught. Okay, well, as these equations in here is what you obtain if your TB is equal T naught. And then by inspecting also this particular equations in here, we know that this term in here is called the dimensionless Brinkmann number. When we say dimensionless, meaning that this particular variable does not have any unit. And it the value of that one is proportional to the viscous dissipation term. Okay. Now, by our intuitions, we know that there will be a particular distance at x where the temperature will be maximum. Okay. So how we do that thing? So how do we find that thing? So we need to find the value of the x where the derivative of the temperature with respect to the x will be equal to zero. So this is what I did, and then I find that that particular positions will be equal to this x equal b multiplied by 1 over dr plus half. Okay, so then when we substitute these things, then we will be able to know what is the maximum temperature. Then another property that you can find from this particular problem is the rate at which the work is done, which is the force acting on the upper plate times the velocity with which it measures. Why we do it on the upper plate? Because the upper plate is the plate that are moving. Okay, so that will be the shear stress multiplied by the W multiplied by the L multiplied by the Vb in here, because that Vb is the velocity at which the upper plate move. If you do that thing, then you will get these things in here, okay, which is basically the same with what you have in here that you get from your previous equations in here, okay, but in here only it's more a bit more apparent in here. So that will be the two questions that the two problems that I want to discuss today for your travel phenomena. You think everything is okay up to this particular point of time in terms of the momentum transport and then the heat transport? You guys are okay with that? No difficulties? All good? Any further questions, Tiara? Sarina, Stephanie, Jonathan, Alvin, Daniel, Evangeline, Gladys, Saif, anything from these two particular examples that I derived in here for you guys? No? No questions? Look, I'm not a fan of putting in too much materials to you to digest, because I know that I think the stamina is getting a bit lower as the semester proceeds, right? What more important than giving a lot of material is actually putting a quality time to think about the material that you have at your hand already, and that will give much better understanding into what you do. So I think the drop-in sessions will not be as long as when I have in the first week, second week, third week, or the fourth week. Okay, so it will gradually get less and less, because I just want to reiterate on some important things that I think needs to be explained within drop-in sessions. But the detail of the process itself, you have to derive it yourself. Okay, so now you, but by now you can understand that within that 3 hours or 4 hours of the take-home test one that I give to you, you will benefit more if you have done the derivation process yourself, because that will make it quicker for you when you do the test. Okay, so whenever you try to solve the transfer phenomena problem, always don't forget to have a paper and pencils with you, and then look at the problem, try to derive it yourself. Don't look at the solution first, but later, after you solve everything, then you compare your final solutions with the derivations that I did in here. Okay, I think that will be all for today's drop-in sessions, and I would encourage you to come also into the tutorial, because Frederick told me that the tutorial attendance has been quite low. I think it's only one or two people show up last Friday. I'm sure the tutorial will benefit you as well. Okay, so hopefully by if these conditions can get better, then I can see you guys again probably next year. Okay, stay well, everybody.